from Fort Worth, Cowtown, USA, it's The Dean Show with your host, Dean Gosden. I'm John Bell, along with Gil the Music Guy and the Dean Show Orchestra. Inviting to join Dean and his guest, Michael D. Gardner, and musical guest, hopefully, Spencer Elliott. And now, here's Dino!
Thank you.
Yeah. All right.
We're running again.
How about that? It's been a couple of years.
It seems like.
Yeah,
almost. It seems like longer than that. Yeah. So, and amazing things have happened the last couple of years. You know, we didn't come back last time because we got busy doing things that paid.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So here we are, and we're going to try to make another run at it again. So anyway, I guess you saw the internet sensation. What was her name? Candace Payne.
Oh, yeah.
Had the uh-huh. the Chewbacca mask.
Sure.
You know, what's amazing about that is that Candace Payne went from just a housewife in Grand Prairie to a big sensation in 6 hours, and now she's too big to be on our show. I blew that one, didn't I? It's better when I said it a while ago. Anyway, and what about, I guess the rest of the news is, politics. You can't get away from that. Who would have figured Trump would have done that? I business guy, Ted Cruz. I'm surprised at that. I saw on the news the other night they had, I guess everybody's embracing that. They had, Greta Van Susteren.
Yeah, close.
She had Meet the Trumps, and she was interviewing the Trumps, the kids, and I guess Ivanka.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. The
yes.
wife. Yeah.
Oh, the wife.
The wife. Yeah.
Melania. I was thinking of a disease.
That's it.
Yeah, right. Okay. Melania. Right. Correct.
And geez, that was just a little awkward. It was. Because she has that accent, it kind of makes her exotic. So, for me, it was kind of like watching a Ferrari sitting next to a '67 Chevy Longo. I see you laughing over there. the thing was that they showed the house. I mean, the house was, it was ornate. I mean, everything was gold. I mean, the crown molding was. I can only imagine that it was real gold. The crown molding, the frames, the floors were gold. Everything was gold. It was sort of like watching an episode of Leave It to Beaver meets King Midas. They all seem like nice folks. Everybody seemed nice. I don't know. I hear they tried to do the same thing with Bill and Hillary, but the news crew kept getting attacked by the gargoyles. So anyway, did you do anything yesterday for Red Nose Day?
I'll tell you, that passed me by entirely.
Yeah, me too. I didn't have a Red Nose Day yesterday. I had one last Tuesday.
Oh, did you?
Planning one in about an hour. So anyway, other than that, I guess that's about all the news. Oh, you know what? I mean, what about, so the Texas Rangers, Yu Darvish is coming back after what they said he had Tommy John's operation?
Mm, Tommy John surgery.
What is that?
It's rotator cuff. Elbow. Elbow surgery.
Why is
right.
it called that? Why is it just called elbow surgery?
Tommy John was the first guy they did that on, that particular procedure. It worked really well.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I was curious about that because I didn't know, because I had Long John Silver surgery one time. Cut myself on a crab leg, but anyway, I guess that's not the same thing. What do they name those things after things like that's like Lou Gehrig's disease, I guess.
Right,
Lou Gehrig
right.
was the ball player that mm-hmm. had that, so that makes sense. But he's going to come back, and I don't understand. Is Frisco the minor league version of the Texas Rangers?
It might be. I'm not sure
because that's where he's pitching right now, is up in Frisco. I thought they were just sort of like a I don't know who they were.
Yeah, minor league.
Yeah, but I didn't know they were the minor league
of
affiliate.
The Rangers,
Like the Dodgers have their they have the the city up in the desert. They have that city up in the desert, which is there, but they're also called the Dodgers.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the Barstow Dodgers or something.
The Triple A version of the Dodgers.
Right, yeah.
Right?
Which I don't know if Frisco's that or not, but anyway. So I didn't know if Tommy John surgery was their key word for still in the minors, going to come back up from. So anyway, okay. Well, listen, let's move along, shall we? We got a great show today. We got Michael P. Gardner and hopefully Spencer Elliott, musical guest, and we'll be back right after these words. Thanks.
What can I do for you?
Do you mind if I smoke?
No, there's no smoking in here. And take your hat off. It shows a sign of respect.
Sorry. I'm doing this television series called Bailout, and we can't even get the networks to look at it. That's all we want. We just want them to look at it.
So why'd you go to the networks? Why didn't you come to me first?
I don't know what to do, Godfather.
You can act like a man instead of crying like a woman.
I'm sorry, Godfather.
I'm going to make the networks an offer. They can't refuse. Now scram.
My name is Jimmy O'Neill. I'm a New York City detective. Some days, I wonder why. As long as I've been on the force, I thought I'd seen just about everything. Men wearing pantyhose. Dumb wise guys.
Yeah, I know who I hit. New York City councilman. And by the way, he's tied to the mob.
I want this guy dead.
My uncle needed me to take over his bail bonds business in Fort Worth, Texas.
How are y'all doing?
Me? What?
I just had to show my NYPD partner, Marty, how things were done in the Lone Star State.
I'm in Texas, going to see a guy by the name of Quabba.
This place is more strange than New York. The women pack heat.
I want you to go down, because I'm a cop!
Day's not over.
Let's just say it was made an offer I couldn't refuse.
This family is my life
bailout.
Thank you for coming back to see us during our commercial breaks. So, hey, Ben.
All right.
Yeah. So, what do you think of the lady with the you know, I was thinking what we should do is we should get some masks, some masks, and we should just sit here.
Try a different mask each week and see which one gets the highest rating.
Right.
So, yeah.
Now, and you know, we're making fun, but you know, good luck to her. I think that's great that she did that.
Sure.
I wonder sometimes about people that struggle really, really hard.
Oh, that's sure. That's how it always goes, right?
I know. Yeah. But, good deal. So, hey, Ben, what have you been doing?
I haven't been doing any show business, honestly.
Really?
You done any?
Yeah, I did a print job down in Austin not too long ago, and just did a tequila commercial about a week ago, which was
Is that right? Like a TV spot or a print job? Yeah.
You know, and it could be, maybe it won't be even seen around here. Who knows?
Yeah.
I haven't seen a tequila commercial in years, so I didn't know they still did them.
I think I've seen some. I know I've seen like bourbon commercials recently, but I don't know that.
Really?
There must be some, I'm sure, yeah.
I've seen a lot of vodka commercials. You know what? So speaking of vodka commercials, mm-hmm. I was watching television the other day. And by the way, I just got cable television.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know what's changing my life?
What?
That finger. That finger does more movement now than any finger has ever done in its life.
Right.
But they had a Grey Goose commercial.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so taken by all the stuff that was going on in the commercial, I didn't even know it was a Grey Goose commercial.
Oh. Okay.
I didn't. They were watching, it was like a blimp. It was like a blimp. And it stopped and these people got on board the blimp and then they went off and they were watching a movie in the clouds and having drinks and stuff, but I never realized. I thought it was, I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
It's a lot of commercials like that where you see them and then you think about, well, what were they advertising?
Exactly. And
missed that entirely. Yeah.
And the one I missed and I wished I hadn't missed was the other night I was doing something and the TV was on it and I don't know what they were advertising or what it was all about, but someone said Mick Booger. That got my...
That did it, huh?
That got my attention.
Drew you in.
I liked that word, and I liked the fact that they used it.
Well, that's a word to the wise ad executives out there. Make sure you... Mick Booger is the one that rings true.
Did you go back to Jersey? I mean,
I've been back to New Jersey since we last met. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah? What are you going on?
It looks the same to me, honestly, yeah. The old neighborhood looks the same. I haven't been out to New York City, but...
You guys say that back from the East, of the old neighborhood.
You don't say that around here?
Yeah, if I go back to Lubbock,
It's not old enough, yeah.
I guess, I don't know. Did you ever say the old neighborhood? No. Arkansas, they never said the old neighborhood either. But you hear people from New York all the time, and that's what they say, back in the old neighborhood.
I guess they used to say the old country, and now it's like the old neighborhood.
Yeah, I guess
moved on a generation, right. So there's no old country, it's old neighborhood.
I guess so. That makes sense. Well, okay then.
Have you worked with our guest today, Michael P. Gardner, before?
No, I never have. I took him down to Austin, where he got a role.
Oh, you guys were at the same audition?
We carpooled down, he got a role.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Same one.
Well,
but anyway, I guess we'll see what he's got going when he gets here. But
yeah.
Anyway, all right, let's get on with the show, and we'll be back in a few minutes after this. Thanks a lot. For a little bit more of me and John, what we want to talk about here is the political arena is just crazy.
It's a world gone mad.
It is. I mean, who would have ever thought this? I mean, it's getting very I don't know if I want to say nasty, but I was listening to one of the networks a while ago, and I mean, there was a lady on there her face was turning red. She was so angry about Trump being in the deal, and then the same thing, you listen to somebody else. I got friends that are for Bernie Sanders,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, they want to murder Hillary Clinton. It's just amazing how split, almost three ways, this country's becoming.
Yeah,
now there's a guy coming up that's going to be the libertarian guy. I don't know what his name is.
Yeah, I never know that either. But
he's been making some inroads. And then everybody's talking about, so the Democrats... So Hillary's won.
Uh-huh.
How, I don't know. I have no idea. Sanders is like, we took this, and we took that, and we took this,
has something to do with the magical superdelegates.
Yeah, whoever those people.
I'm not sure what that means. Yeah.
I don't either, but it seems kind of rigged, and everybody's saying it seems kind of rigged for old Bernie. But he's apparently not even in it anymore, but he's still going, and I think that's going to cause you know, that's going to cause some problems when we get to the convention. But see, here's the thing. Here's the thing is that people are now speculating that what's going to happen is that the FBI is going to indict Hillary on the email scandal.
Right.
Bernie is already out, and so they're going to parachute in. I like the term. He's going to come from the ceiling of the convention center.
Duex Machina.
Yeah. Yes. Joe Biden.
Right, of course.
And he's going to just kind of do one of these things, you That's, know, yeah. and walk up to the microphone.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm the guy.
Oh yeah.
And then on the other side of the they're saying the same thing about Donald Trump, mm-hmm. that they're gonna parachute in some guy to
trying to get right.
But he's got all the delegates. He's got enough delegates that he needs. So I guess we gotta come down on the side somewhere, don't we?
Well, yeah, that's the question: is what which candidate will get the valuable Dean Show endorsement?
The one who wins.
Okay. That's one way of going about it.
That's
yes.
right. The one who wins.
Back the winner.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're
going
to back the winner. We're going to show up the day after voting and say, that was our guy.
Yeah.
Or girl.
All right.
But yeah, it's a real crazy barn burner. And there's more people registered to vote now than it's ever registered in the past. And it's just...
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is. But then again, there's a lot of people now that are saying, well, you know, if it's going to be Trump, I'm not going to vote. If it's going to be Hillary, I'm not even going to vote.
Well, we'll see if they really follow through on that when election day rolls
we'll
around.
See. All right. Okay. All right. We got to go. Okay, all right. So anyway, break time, right? Oh, yeah. Okay. We got to go. So anyway, we'll be back in a few minutes with Michael P. Gardner. And like I said, hopefully Spencer Elliott will be here to sing us a song and find out what he's doing these days. So anyway, thanks a lot. Guest is a local actor, been in several television shows and commercials. You may have seen him around. Please welcome Michael P. Gardner.
Very proud. How you doing, buddy? Good to see you.
All right. So, hey, man.
Busy.
Yeah?
Very well, thank you.
That's good.
Busy is good. How about you?
Good. I'm a little bit here and there, not too much. You seem to be getting most of the stuff I auditioned for.
Well,
but you know what? Here's the deal. Okay, here's the deal. And you make fun of this too, that you get a lot of cops.
I get more cop roles than.
And
than
how many people have you killed?
I've killed a lot of people. Right. I think the number's around 38.
Right. Well, here's the deal. I mean, you got that look, and I'm not saying you got that look because you got that look.
My head's just getting larger. But go on.
No, but here's the deal. So I called the local sheriff department a couple of weeks ago because I had a little issue going on.
You didn't mention my name.
No.
Oh, okay.
But it could have been you that drove up. Because the guy drove up and he looked just like
was
you.
Was he my doppelganger?
It was, man. And I was up the street and I said, you know where I live, right? And he goes, uh-uh. And I said, oh, I thought I'd talked to you before because the last guy I talked to looked like you too. So it's become like the cop look.
Yeah, we're a drone cop force zombie actor militia. That's top secret. We're trying to keep it underground. That way, when the apocalypse happens, we'll take over.
Right. So you like playing cops?
I do. I like playing cops. You know, it's always fun to play the authority figure and things like that. I'm not gonna say it's getting old. I mean, I love the work no matter what I'm doing. So even if I'm just doing some silly things like arresting somebody or handcuffing somebody on set, that's fine with me. But I'm kind of trying to graduate to a little more in-depth type characters.
Right.
Maybe a bad cop, a dirty cop, with a secret to hide. I think that would be a really good role for me.
A flamboyant artist?
Maybe a flamboyant artist would be a good role as well.
Well, you see, the reason I say that... I never thought about it.
What do you think?
And, well, the reason I say that, and I'm kind of joking...
And by flamboyant, you mean...
Well, I mean just like...
Energetic.
Right. Fabulous.
You are a kind man.
Is because we tend to get caught in roles and we never stretch out of those roles and we get into something that's way out of our element.
Yeah.
And a lot of actors, from what I understand, really like to go to a place they've never been before.
Yeah.
So they can really,
yeah, for sure,
really try something new. And I was just curious.
Just watching an interview with Don Cheadle and he said exactly that. If somebody asked him what kind of roles does he look for when he looks at scripts, and he says, just something I haven't done before.
He pays money.
Don Cheadle, he's worked on everything, on the face of the planet, so it's hard for him to find something that he hasn't done before, but amazing actor who he is. But I recently booked something that I'm excited about in June. It's a local feature film called Telephoto.
Yeah.
It's written and directed by Richard Bailey, who's a pretty well-known local filmmaker. He's a very literary, poetic writer, and it's a very, very interesting look at the city of Oak Cliff and how it's changed over the decades in Dallas, and how it's been basically one culture has paved over the previous, and the condos go up, the apartments go up, the parking lots go up, and the history of a town loses its grip. And there's a theory called palimpsest, where a culture builds on top of the previous culture and basically just destroys any history that culture would have had. And Oak Cliff is kind of experiencing that over the last century, and even more changes are on the way. So this film is I can't say that it's a ghost story, but it's not a horror film, if that makes any sense. But it's a very intelligent, mm-hmm. intellectual film about city life, city culture.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, that's... I think Rome experienced the same thing.
For sure, absolutely. I think once you reach an extreme, you have to go
right.
somewhere.
What role are you?
I play a skate punk stoner named Charlie, which is a real stretch for me. We're talking about trying to find roles that stretch our acting wings. I'm really going to have to work on the stoner part. And I grew up in the 70s, so I rode the skateboard. My friends and I had the half pipe in our backyard with the plywood, and annoying the neighbors until the wee hours of the morning, and all that fun stuff. So yeah, I have a little bit of experience with the skateboarding culture.
So you're like a middle-aged sport,
yeah.
middle-aged dropout kind of a character,
kind of a washed-up. Washed up skater. He used to be cool. He used to be kind of like Matthew McConaughey's character in Days Confused, really cool kind of guy. But now he's older. He's got some injuries, and he can't quite skate like he used to.
Maybe one day you'll do a web talk show.
It's an interesting character. In fact, I'm still kind of developing the character.
So when does it shoot?
We have several dates in June. I have four shoot dates in June, and then one more in July. So over the next couple of months, you're starting in a couple of weeks.
And then it's going to go to the film festival circuit? Or?
Yeah, more than likely the local film festival circuit, certainly the Oak Cliff Film Festival, which they just had. And so it'll be at that next year. And Richard has had films in South by Southwest and some of the big festivals. So
that's
I'm
awesome.
Really looking forward to seeing how this comes out and where it can go
cool.
from there.
So the question I have is I understand that you've only been really in acting for 4 or 5 years, and you had kind of an interesting start to your acting career.
I did. It's a really long story. I'll try to make it short, but at age 45, I was living in a small apartment, Grapevine. I'd just gotten fired from my job. I was an operations manager at Super Shuttle. And 2 days after I got fired, I got an email from a girl who I had dated a few years previous, and she was a casting agent. She sent me an email, asked me if I want to be an extra for $50, and I was out of work, so I said yes. So I went and I worked on this little film called Bad Kids Go to Hell with Judd Nelson. It had Judd Nelson, and it was basically a spinoff of Breakfast Club. It was a horror Breakfast Club. And so I went and I worked on this film, and while I was there, I met some really great people. I loved the process. I've always been a creative guy, and I just got bit by the bug, man. Immediately, I fell in love with the whole process. I mean, I've been a musician all my life. I like to write, so I have a lot of creative outlets, but acting was one that I had never dabbled in, and as soon as I stuck my foot in the pool, it was over.
Right.
It's just been gangbusters.
And so, how did you do that? We got a break? Okay. We'll be right back.
Awesome. Yeah, I'll be right here.
Guys, yeah, we'd like to welcome a new sponsor to the Dean Show, Dallas Resale. They have a lot of nice things. If you want anything from a blender to a mattress, I think, or clothes to wax flowers, but anyway, they do a great job over in Dallas. And we'll be right back with more Michael P. Gardner right after this. Thank you.
Attention Metroplex, there's a new sheriff in town. Dallas Resale is the new place to buy the best for less. Check out new brand name baby products, toys, electronics, blenders, vacuum cleaners, men's colognes, and women's perfumes, all at wholesale prices. Come check out the fastest growing resale store in North Texas, located at 1225 West College Avenue, Suite 504 in Carrollton, or call 972-466-1269. Dallas Resale, where you buy the best for less at wholesale prices.
All right, welcome back. Thank you very much. So you got a couple of demos you're going to show us. You're going to show us a dramatic one?
I do. I have a dramatic reel and a commercial reel.
Okay.
I also have a comedic reel, but I did not bring that because I just feel a little intimidated by your comedic force, Dean.
Well, gosh, you shouldn't.
No, seriously.
You saw the monologue, you were really saying, I shouldn't.
Ooh. Yeah, the first thing you'll see is me on American Crime. I had a co-starring role on American Crime. I believe you and I both auditioned for that role.
I remember that. Thanks
yeah,
for
Dean drove us down there in his Mercedes, gave me the first class service all the way down there, and I booked that thing. And I never told him. How did you find out that I booked it? Do you
I think they sent me an email from the casting agency. Said, "God, why did you show up with all that stupid line? You couldn't even get that one line out right, and so we picked the other guy."
Yeah, I think I was just a little more energetic that day. Yeah.
No, I think I saw something on Facebook that you'd posted that you had just gotten a co-star someplace. So I kind of put.
Yeah, it was really kind of cool. I mean, I don't like to brag about roles or anything, but that was a really big milestone for me because in less than 5 years, I had gone from just being a background actor who had never had any acting experience at all to a co-starring role on an Emmy-winning TV show working for an Academy Award-winning director. And sitting in my trailer there while we were shooting that day, it really all kind of, sorry. Sitting in my trailer, right after they brought the wardrobe, the director comes in, brings me a cup of tea. No, that's when it kind of all came together for me, how far I had come in such little time. And it was almost like a, I can do this moment for me.
Good for you, man. I was glad you got that. I think I responded back, glad you got that. So.
Yeah, you did. You were very gracious about it. And it could have gone either way. I saw your audition. It was pretty awesome.
Yeah, I don't take roles. That's
guest starring up for you, right?
Okay, so let's look at those right now.
Yes.
And then we'll come back and talk about them in just a second. So
awesome.
Just watch the monitors.
Came to the show when the scene got cracking on time. Young folks made the beat drop when the girls got low when the buns got cracking on stop.
Kevin, what up, man? You
all
going to win on Friday?
Oh, no doubt. Come on by. We going to light it up.
Hey, tell your mama I said hello.
All right, for sure. Have a good one.
Take the gun, Chuckles. Time to prove your worth.
No, you're gonna take care of Lisa, because we're both getting out of here today.
I lost my kids, June and Andy.
She left my sight again near the hunting grounds.
Well, sir, that is one heck of a story.
Yes, sir. Pirates and balloon animals don't go together, but Twix and ice cream do.
What is it?
A snake.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Miss Brown, I'm sorry. It's gonna take us a while to evaluate your claim.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
I can't help you with a rental car.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Look, I've got a lot of files to go over.
Lord Jesus, watch out now.
Catchphrase decades can start a party in an instant, even in an elevator.
I wear a mask, I ride a horse.
I've been your dream.
Yeah, there you go. Nice job. Did I tell you? The cop looks just like you, the cop. Right. It looks just like the cop that came into my driveway.
And you thought it was me or you were going to jail?
I did. I told the cop, I said, aren't you supposed to be here in 2 weeks? That was nice. So you enjoyed doing that? Where'd you film that?
I do. We shot that in Austin, just outskirts of Austin there at an intersection. The scene was... at an intersection, I was in a cop. I pull up and talk to one of the stars of the show. It was great fun. I had a lot of good memories from the show. The director really did come to my trailer to talk about the scene with me, which I thought was the coolest thing ever. I was thinking, just a second, sir. Let me Facebook this. It was just I was just like a kid in a candy store.
That's funny.
But yeah, it was 2-3 lines, but.
So the other things that are in there, the guy that shoots the gun and the black shirt, and then but what's interesting to me is, okay, so back to stretching.
Mm-hmm.
What stuck out the most was not the guy shooting the gun or the two guys saying, well, that's a funny story or that's an interesting story, but it's the guy bending down in the woods that had the English accent saying,
it's a German man.
Oh, was it German?
It's a German. Yeah,
but
well, actually,
there was one guy that had an English accent. Right?
Well, that was an Australian accent actually.
Ah, okay.
That was Major Blood from a G.I. Joe fan film. Australian, English, bit different.
Yeah,
wee bit different.
Right.
German. Nothing like English at all.
No.
Well, that was French or something. I don't even know what that was. Right. But no, I was playing a German Jew who was trying to escape the Nazi war machine in a period piece with a bunch of gypsies.
Was that here?
Yeah, we shot. That was actually a student film.
Really?
Isaias Gallardo from UTA, University of Texas in Arlington.
Oh, that guy, yeah.
Fantastic filmmaker. And that's where I met a lot of my best friends in the acting industry. It's very early on in my career. I think maybe 6 months I was acting,
yeah.
And I'd do that, and that was one of the milestone moments for me in the way that I my life had come full circle. There I was, 45 years old, in the woods with a gun, pretending to shoot Nazis, and you know, I'm waiting for I think I was hiding behind a tree, and I was waiting for the director to call action, and I'm thinking to myself, I'm in my head, and I'm in the woods shooting Nazis, and how old am I? So you know. Since I was 12, I've been wanting to get back out to the woods, but, you know, life gets in the way.
Right.
And so, you know, I had a kind of poignant moment there in the woods where now I get to chase Nazis through the woods and shoot people, and I get paid for it.
That's good. Wait, that was all very interesting. I guess the other stuff you shot around here, too?
Yeah, I've done a lot of short films. That's really how I got my, I put my foundation of my career together on short films, student films, because... As an actor, you need, in order to get an agent, you need some speaking roles on a resume, and you need a demo reel with you speaking. So,
right.
I mean, working background and working as extras is a great place to start, but you have to take it to the next level, and the next level is an agent and, you know, real acting roles. And since the beginning, that's where I was headed. There was never any question about what.
So let's talk about the commercial, and here's something I got to share with you that I just feel obligated to do it now. Is that I auditioned for that stupid pirate
movie. So, are you kidding me?
Yeah, just so you know.
Oh, my gosh. I just shrunk about 3 inches.
You did a great job. It was good. But I want to hear about you. You said something,
something
with Jared from Subway.
I did. Well, it was that was just a background thing. But, yeah, we were over at AMS Studios in Dallas.
You're doing a lot of
I did. Well, Yeah, he was very nice. He didn't seem pedophilic or pedophilic or whatever the word would be. I don't know what he was accused of. I really don't pass judgment on other people. I don't get involved in that sort of thing. But he was nice, a very quiet guy, very calm and good-natured,
yeah.
Sort of sweet guy. But Yeah. And then the pirate thing was a lot of fun, too. That was my first time I'd ever worked.
Yeah, that looked like it was fun.
I spent the entire day as this guy. So I talked like this for about 14 hours straight.
We'll be right back right after this.
And I guarantee everybody...
We're sitting here talking with Michael P. Gordon. And,
what a great crowd. I didn't realize you could get this many people.
It's a magic.
Absolutely. Hey, thanks for coming, everybody.
So I got a question. I got a question that you brought something up a few minutes ago that sparked a little light bulb in my head. You said I was a musician.
Yes, I was.
What do you do? What did you do?
Back to high school, I was in a rock band in high school.
You played the guitar, drums?
I played guitar and I sang in a band in high school, and we were just a little cover band. We did some Quiet Riot and some Rush songs, and you know, this was in the 80s, by the way.
That's okay, I'm still going, who was that?
Right.
Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young.
After high school, I went in the military, and I kind of dropped the guitar. I didn't pick it up again until, I think right after my divorce. I think right after I left my wife for the first time. No, I'm kidding. About 30 years old, I picked up the guitar again. It was right after the internet became popular in the 90s or so, I think. And I was 30-something, and I decided to pick up the guitar again. And then I retaught myself how to play on the internet using tabs and websites and stealing songs, downloading from Napster and fun things like that. And then,
because I have a guitar right there.
Do you really? I would actually be honored to not even come close to touching it. I would really appreciate that. No, I haven't played in a long time, and I was in another band in my 30s. We were the Cult tribute band. Remember the band The Cult?
Sure.
Ian Asbury. We were a tribute band for The Cult. We played all the Cult songs and
Firewoman,
yes, sir. She sells Sanctuary and all the great tunes. Shout out to all my buddies there from the band. But that got kind of old after a while. Being a rock star was kind of just boring for a minute, I guess. And so I set it down and didn't do anything really creatively until the actor thing at age 45. So I think I was overdue with a life changing creative outlet there. So. Maybe I'm late.
So with your creative side and being an actor, I mean, everybody in our world is writing and producing their own stuff. You got any aspirations of writing and producing and all that?
I have written quite a bit of stuff. About 10 years ago, I started keeping a personal journal, just on a quest for self-help and to improve my life, and it really, really changed my writing ability, my ability to express myself with words and a pen. And yeah, I do. On occasion, I get to the point where something comes into my mind, and I just start writing about it. And 5 hours later, I have 12 pages that I've, that are all over the place. So it happens. It comes in a little spurts, like every other creative outlet. Sometimes you have to let it out, and you have to right. Scratch that itch. And writing is. I like photography, love photography.
I got an outlet, but it comes in a tin can.
nice. So you get the expensive kind.
Yeah. I don't get the expensive kind.
Well, I figured the tin can was...
$4 a 12-pack.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Just kidding.
Is that a plug for Schlitz?
Do they make Schlitz anymore?
I don't know, but if they do, they need to send me some.
Yeah, my dad used to drink Schlitz. And I was.
I know I could find somebody to drink it.
Yeah, I always remember the Schlitz in the icebox.
Did your dad put salt in his beer?
No.
Wasn't that a thing when you were a kid? My dad always put...
Oh, yeah, I think so.
Or
yeah.
Maybe it was my grandfather. I don't think my dad drank that much, but grandfather. He always put salt in a beer.
Yeah, it seemed like I remember people doing that in a bar. Made it fuzz up a lot.
Hey, let's take something that's not real good for your liver and make it even worse.
Right. Yeah.
Yay!
My dad drank Schlitz and
He has some kind of liquor he drank. Old Crow.
No, that was what he called your, you know, that was what he called your mom.
Yeah. Hey. He was no, it wasn't what he called mom.
I hope your mom's not gonna see this. I'm so sorry. I don't even know you. I'm sure you're a lovely lady.
Yeah, she's
a great son here. He's a little
she's watching right now.
Is
but
she?
Yeah.
I'm sure she is.
Yeah. No, wrong way. But anyway.
Okay. Wow.
But anyway, no, Old Crow, I remember, he didn't drink a lot, but he used to have this Old Crow that he had in the cabinet that I'd always see when I was looking.
So it was an actual crow that he kept his liquor in?
No, it was a bottle. It was called Old Crow.
Some sort of
liquor he drank.
I gotcha.
He'd have one every night when he got home, and he'd fall asleep in the recliner. So.
I see.
So what's so you got this telephoto coming up?
Yeah, I got the telephoto movie coming up.
And what's after that?
I don't know. I've auditioned for a whole lot of stuff here recently, and I don't like to sit around and wait by the phone, but I just keep plowing forward, keep auditioning as much as possible. I just look at auditions as an opportunity for me to do my thing. If I don't book it, no big deal.
Have you ever thought about theater?
Yes, I've thought a lot about it, and the more I think about it, the more I realize that how I would probably suck at it. I have the worst short-term memory, and I would probably jump from one scene, from scene 3 to scene 12, and just anger everybody in the whole theater. I don't know.
Believe me, half the people in the theater don't know what you're doing. they're happy that you're there doing
so. If you just go with the flow and keep plowing.
I did. I can't remember who directed it. It was same time next year, and I played.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I played George, and I remember at the intermission or at the end of the show, I forget, because the lady I was doing that played the other side, she was busy with something. She didn't learn a line, so she had the magazines, had her script,
and
she opened it to read her stuff, and she kept getting screwed up.
That's just amateur.
And the director said we went from the first act to the second act, back to the first act, several times in that first act.
Oh, did crazy. I miss my
But the
cue?
Thing is, nobody knew it but us.
Sure, right.
Anyway, we got to take a break. Okay, we're going to take a break.
Awesome.
We'll be back in a few more minutes. So come back right after this. Thanks. So I want to ask, because I've seen posts about it, and I've never seen it because it's on, I guess, cable. Maybe now that I've got cable, I think. Now that I've got cable, maybe I'll see it. But you also did Salem.
Yes, yes.
Right.
The first season of Salem, I started out working as a militiaman in the pilot episode. And then they kept calling me back to work in more and more episodes. There were 13 episodes in the first season.
And what is that on?
It's on WGN,
Superstation
WGN.
I think I get that.
WGN used to be the small station out of Chicago. Now they're a superstation.
Yeah.
But Salem was actually their first scripted series for WGN, and it was quite a success for them, actually. But yeah, it was a thrill to work 10 episodes of a 13 episodes series. Again, working with some really great artists that are doing what it is that I want to do. So, I mean, acting class, coaches, all that out the window. When you're on set and you're standing there watching these people do their thing, to me, that's the best learning experience, and it always has been.
Right.
So I've worked a lot of background. I worked on Dallas. I worked on Salem. I've worked on a lot of TV shows. I've worked on a lot of commercials. I don't do much background anymore because I've kind of moved past that in my career-wise, but that's my bread and butter where I learned about the industry. I learned about where to be on a set, what to do on a set. I learned what it takes to be a recurring role on a TV series.
And did you play the same person all the time, or did you like these?
Yeah. I was a militiaman, and basically, we were the police, and we would hang the witches or corral any troublemakers or fire our muskets at any.
Yeah, ghost. Some ways I'm glad. I'm sorry, some of those days are gone. No, just kidding.
But I also
witches.
I also did a featured role in episode 6.
I love Bewitched.
Oh, me too. That was the coolest thing ever. Episode 6 of season 1 of Salem is called The Red Rose and the
Samantha
Briar.
Samantha Stevens was just the coolest.
Samantha Stevens was so hot. She was like dragging. She's like, hey, Samantha, do that thing again. Wait, one more. No, seriously.
I don't want to be there.
No,
anyway,
in episode 6 of Salem, it's called the Red Rose and the Briar, I think. It's something of that nature. But they asked me to be a zombie. They wanted me to get me. I'd always been hesitant to play zombie characters because there's really not a whole lot of dialogue. Not the deepest character portrayals in a zombie. And so, not that it was below me, but I never really was interested in the. Andre from Legacy Casting said, you know what, Mike, we need a featured background artist for a zombie, and you'd be made up by Matthew Mungle, who won the Academy Award for Bram Stoker's Dracula. He'll be your personal makeup artist. Nice. And so I was like, seriously, I said, yeah, I'll do it. So I got to hang out with Matthew, made up as a zombie for about 2 hours. We shot in the woods. It was really, really a cool scene. I'm a total fanboy when it comes to horror films and things like that. I'm getting chills just talking about my own role. How narcissistic is that? I'm so excited for me. Yay! No, but seriously, it was a really, really cool experience to work with those guys on Salem. I really miss my Salem family. And if you're watching this,
is that going to come up again? Or?
Actually, they just finished.
It looks interesting.
They just shot. They just wrapped a few weeks ago on season 3. And that'll start airing, I believe their premiere episode is on Halloween, October 30th.
So after 30th. Season 1, they sort of blew you off.
Oh, well, actually, no. Son of a... Actually, I was in the first episode of season 2, and a little known trivia, I'm actually in two different places at the same time in season 2, episode 1. I'm a Boston militiaman, and then the next scene, I'm a Salem militiaman.
That should go on your IMDb page.
It should, right? Well, you know, I keep putting it up there, but they just keep taking it down. They say it's not a valid. No, I'm just kidding. I do have some Salem credits on there. They were awesome.
I kept seeing that. I see other Morgana Shaw puts up.
Morgana, yeah, Morgana's an amazing actor. I absolutely adore her. She has so much going for her.
I met her years and years ago. Some class. Something.
She has an absolute timeless beauty mixed with a theatrical skill that's rare nowadays.
Yeah.
And so, well, checks in the mail, Morgana?
That's good. Are we, where are we at? Doing good?
Are we out of time already?
That's funny.
It seems like we've only been...
That's why we have our new showrunner, to keep us kind of online.
She is pretty awesome.
Melanie Mason.
Melanie Mason.
Yeah. So, anyway. All right, so we're going to wrap it up.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Glad you came. Glad you're on board with us.
And thank you. Thank everybody for showing up. I love you for asking. My Twitter handle is Babe Wrangler. That's BabeWrangler. Babe Wrangler, just like it sounds.
All right.
You can catch me on the Facebook at facebook.com/grapevineactor, or you can Google me. I love to be Googled. Michael P. Gardner. So just Google me, and you can see all of my work on the internets.
Yep. Check out Michael, and we'll be back in about a month. Who remembers what that's from? Anybody?
We'll be back in about a month.
Anybody?
Oh, yeah, I have no idea.
Saturday Night Live, that was Dan Aykroyd doing telepsychic.
Oh, boy, wow.
Yeah, telepsychic.
Dean, you ignorant slut.
Yeah, he would somebody call in and say, yeah, is this going to happen or is this going to happen? He goes, yeah, I see you getting a job in about a month, and then you're going to find somebody to be your boyfriend in about a month. Okay?
I know we're going over, but remember the Aykroyd character with the dangerous toys? Yeah, it's a bag of glass. It's kids love glass. It's shiny, and kids love, they love a bag of glass.
It's a bass-o-matic. Anyway, we got to get out of here, right? We're done. We're done. Okay.
Save the liver!
Yeah, save
the liver!
Thank you for coming.
Oh, my!
We'll see you in about a month.